Welcome to Rainier Avenue Radio.world and our special edition of the impacts of the coronavirus on South Seattle. It's me, your host, Tony B. And once again, we will have conversations with members of our community in a discussion about how the coronavirus is impacting South Seattle and surrounding communities. This week on our Friday program, we'll initially be joined by Darryl Smith, the executive director of Homesight, tell you a little bit more about who Homesight is. Steve Polinek will be joining us. He is a virologist, and he'll be giving us some information on viruses and sales and how all these things worked and interact. And so if you want to find out a lot more detail about the coronavirus and how these types of viruses work and function and what they do, make sure and be here for that. We'll also have someone from the police department, and then at 2:30 we will have Jeff Duchin from the King County Health, who will discuss the big picture of what this is going to look like for us now, tomorrow, and in the future. Right now I have on the line with me Mr. Darryl Smith. Darryl, are you there? Hello, Darryl.
Yeah, I'm here. Tony, can you hear me?
I can. Thank you, Darryl. Want to just give a little bit of background information on who you are. Again, Rainier Avenue Radio, when we started doing this initially, our goal was to amplify what was taking place in South Seattle in our community, as we knew there would be circumstances that would manifest themselves because of the diversity of our community. And Homesight is in South Seattle. I want to tell you a little bit about Darryl, who's a South Seattle resident and has been for a long time. Darryl's built a long history of experience in the arenas of real estate, brokerage, neighborhood revitalization, municipal government, workforce development for young adults, and place-based community development. He's held a variety of civic roles, including the presidency of the Rainier Valley Chamber, been a member of the Seattle Planning Commission, and appointed member of the Mayor's Economic Opportunity Task Force in 2009. Darryl was appointed deputy mayor of the city of Seattle, where he served for 4 years overseeing the departments of neighborhood, civil rights, housing, human services, and economic development for Mayor Mike McGinn. Darryl has been an active participant in the lifeblood of Southeast Seattle for over 25 years, most notable as chair of Columbia City's revitalization in the early 90s and as the originator of the celebrated monthly music event, Beat Walk. Darryl.
Tony.
You know I had to give you some South Seattle love.
Thank you, man. It's good to be on the air with you. And thank you so much for what you're doing. This service is really vital. Amplifying voices, particularly in these times, are so incredible because there's just so much confusion and, frankly, anxiety out here. And we need folks like you and others providing this service to keep us informed and letting us know, you know, how we can connect and find the services that all of us so really desperately need right now. It's tough out here. So I appreciate what you're doing.
Well, we cater to, as you know, South Seattle, the Rainier Avenue corridor and the diverse community there. But also, this messaging is, of course, for surrounding communities because we're not isolated. As a result of this, Darryl, our initial broadcast started on March 13th when Seattle was considered the epicenter of COVID-19. And our local audience has grown. One of the byproducts of this evidently was because of the multicultural community that we live in. Our regional audience grew, our national audience grew, and even the international audience grew. So I just wanted to make you aware of that as we started the interview. However, our focus is still and will continue to be on our residents of South Seattle. So for folks who might not know, Darryl, about Homesight, can you give us a little background information on who Homesight is and what Homesight does?
Yeah, absolutely. So Homesight's been around for about 30 years here in South Seattle, offices right here on Rainier Avenue at the south end of Columbia City. And a second office opened up some years ago, which is our home ownership center, which is down at the Othello Station, right in the station building. And Homesight's longtime mission is really to create opportunity and frankly build wealth in low income and moderate income communities, particularly communities of color, through home ownership. So we're a lender. If you are at 80% area median income for this area and outside of the city, we can be your lender, first or second mortgage, because we want families to build that generational wealth through home ownership. We're also an anti-displacement organization because we provide those same types of services, including back during the last Great Recession. We did rescue loans for families. We did over 300 of them, where, you know, it could be from $5,000 to maybe $20,000 to keep someone from going into foreclosure. So we're really all about creating those opportunities, building wealth. And something that's really near and dear to me is we're a community development corporation. We're a place-based community development corporation. So we partner with organizations, community benefit organizations, small business associations right here in our community to help strengthen and build what I would call, you know, community capital. So it's a really important mission. And right now, during this COVID crisis, when we know that, frankly, across the country, and we're no different here in South Seattle, that this epidemic hits communities of color in a sense even harder, because very often, you know, we don't necessarily have the same access to healthcare. We may not have the same access to goods and services, and so it's amplified in a sense. And when we think about those in our community that you know are often the sort of, you know, not necessarily the first hired, you know, economically it hits us really hard. And so this is something that Homesight really wanted to focus in on. We have really great relationships with a lot of our small business neighbors up and down the Rainier corridor and in South Seattle. And what we heard loud and clear was, and it's not that much different for the rest of the city, but I think it hits us in a sense harder, that our small business owners, many of which are run by immigrant refugee families, other minority groups, women-owned businesses, were not necessarily gaining access to, you know, the Paycheck Protection Program, the CARES Act in general. I think the city has stepped up in some regard to help out businesses, and I was happy to see some of those awards go out to business owners here in South Seattle, which is fantastic. But we also knew that we had a gap to fill as well, and we could play a role in getting some dollars out as quickly as possible to our really small business owners. So we set up a fund. It was about $150,000. We got over 250 applications in 4 days, Tony. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's the kind of need that's out here. And, you know, frankly, we could have awarded a lot more if I had more money. So we're trying to do a second round and build another small fund to get dollars out. So what we did was we created a really simple online platform where business owners could go in and talk to us just really briefly about their business. We didn't want this to be, you know, overtaxing, because there's enough, you know, anxiety and challenge out here anyway. We wanted to make it really easy. And so they wrote in, as I say, 250 applications. We were able to, with the criteria we'd set up, which is POC business, women-owned, employees 10 or less, and half of the awardees have to have 5 employees or less. We looked at how many family members that business was supporting, and we made our awards, and we hope to get the money out the door today, it being the 1st of May.
And you know, Darryl, one of the things that we have, along with talking about some of the unanticipated challenges that occurred because of the coronavirus pandemic, we've also shared stories of the resilience of our community and the dynamic community, the way the community has responded to the needs that we have. One of the things that we were aware of in our community is from the beginning is that there were going to be some challenges because of the diversity in our community. And it seemed like it took almost a month for the rest of the country to catch up to the fact that the disparities that were in place prior to COVID-19 were going to exacerbate the problem. But we knew that right away. And so I'm really happy and excited to be able to share what Homesight does and the way that our community, again, rallied the wagons in support of, again, the needs that we have. I want to talk more about that program, but I do want to talk a little bit about, before we get there, about what's going on at Othello, because folks may not know about what's happening at Othello and Homesight's involvement and engagement up there in that area in Othello.
Yeah, thank you for asking about that. It's It's really exciting, and it truly is what we would call equitable place-based development. It may be one of the few types of projects of its kind on the West Coast, in that it really started several years ago. And I've been executive director at Homesight really only since January, but I have a long-time relationship with the organization going back to the early 90s, because they've been so deeply embedded in our community as an organization partnering with folks. But what we did is brought together the community over the course of several, you know, large and small gatherings to really get a sense about what are the community needs that are out here. And a lot of those needs were identified by community, and what we're trying to deliver in a stellar campus area right there at Martin Luther King Boulevard and Othello across from the Safeway is the kind of a campus where all community members could find themselves. So there'll be three different types of housing there available. There'll be some affordable home ownership through a co-op building. Over 68 units are what are planned for there. And it's a low point of entry. So again, how do you build that kind of generational wealth in your family through home ownership? The co-op model, which is very prevalent where I'm from back east in the New York area, not really so much here on the West Coast or frankly in Seattle. So we hope to have that as a model. Then there'll be two other levels of affordable housing there, affordable rentals. And then in what we call the Opportunity Center, what we're trying to create there is actual equity ownership for community organizations. So part of the challenge, you know, that we see is, you know, community organizations do great work, but they don't necessarily own their own real estate. And then they're subject to the whims of the market and all of that. We want to create a place where community organizations can actually own their space. So we're working on that. We'll also have some affordable commercial space for rental opportunities there. There'll be classroom space there, state-of-the-art classroom space where, you know, you've got all of the audiovisual and internet capability to do those sort of, you know, place-based meetings or meetings away. So you can do trainings there. We really want to create a center there that's almost like a mini version of the convention center, but focused on South Seattle, where the community really feels like they have a place. There'll be a credit union there. All of the opportunities there to further education, further your business interests, get technical assistance. Also on the campus, in one of our buildings, there'll be a real showplace there, because the Odessa Brown Children's Clinic will be locating to Othello Square with a state-of-the-art facility for all of the healthcare needs for our young people and our families. There'll be a charter school there and a really huge plaza where the entire community can gather for celebrations and what have you. So it's really an amazing opportunity here. We're in the middle of planning and developing and working with folks to bring all of that together. Of course, none of us were counting on a global pandemic here. So we're having to continue our work, but also be mindful of what's on everybody's mind. So, you know, the work continues, but perhaps not quite at the same pace that we were experiencing a couple of months ago.
I appreciate that explanation, Darryl. Again, that's how we get down in South Seattle. A lot of times
that's right.
In mainstream media, the only thing you hear about is if there was a crime or a shooting or something happened, and amazing, incredible things happen within our community every day. And so really happy to have this opportunity. I wanted to just share that with folks about something that was going on in our community. Darryl, we're talking about this is Rainier Avenue Radio. It's me, Tony. Be my guest is Darryl Smith, who is the executive director of Homesight, which you just heard about. Darryl, we're talking about the coronavirus, the impact on South Seattle. One of the things, that you did, you mentioned you raised $150,000. Let's talk about this, because you did this really quickly. What went on at Homesight when this first started to hit, and as things began to come out about how serious this was going to be? Tell us what took place at Homesight. Was there an emergency plan already in place that you were following? How did you get to the point where you said, hey, this is how we're going to contribute to benefiting our community?
Yeah, I appreciate that question, Tony. So I had asked the whole staff to essentially begin working from home and getting all of the technical sort of stuff in place to make that a reality actually before the governor had come out with his pronouncement, because we sort of knew that in a sense this was probably going to happen. So we were a few days ahead of the game on that, but something that did become very apparent to us was again our really outstanding business and community development manager Sarah Valenta, who lives right here in the South End, not too far from where I live actually, was hearing from a lot of our business owners. We had originally were going to be launching right about the same time when COVID hit. Our celebrated Plate of Nations. It's like South Seattle's own little bite of Seattle, right? So 9 different venues, you get a passport. And, you know, we like to say here in the South End, of course, you know, come to the Valley, see the world, right? Because we've got everything down here. We've got just the best food and people and families representing almost all corners of the planet, frankly. Mm-hmm. So Plate of Nations had to be put on hold. And we're like, well, how can we support those restaurants where folks are not going to experience Plate of Nations? So we came up with a way to support them through gift cards where you could buy the gift card and then use it later. So we would get a couple of bucks in those restaurateurs' hands. But the issue became larger for us, and we had a couple of bucks left over from a grant we received from the Office of Economic Development, where last year we had put out some very small awards for small businesses to, you know, to help themselves grow a little bit, to maybe put a down payment on, say, a new dishwasher or something like that. So these weren't very large awards, but we were happy to participate. When Sarah started hearing from businesses how incredibly stressing this was and not having immediate help, we basically went into action and said, well, can we take what we did last year but supercharge it, right? Mm-hmm. So we decided to double the size of the awards, and we just immediately reached out to some foundations and investors that have been working with Homesight for years, like Lucky Seven Foundation. We were able to get Office of Economic Development to continue to help out. The Rainier Valley Community Development Fund immediately helped out. And again, like you say, you know, we're so much about helping one another down here that I was really gratified, but frankly not surprised by how quickly people responded. So the foundations, we also have a relationship with Umpqua Bank. We're one of their partners in terms of their supporting our community development efforts. They wrote a check. So we got answers really fast, and we're able to build that fund to 150 pretty quickly, because our goal again was to get the word out and get the money out quickly too. So it really came together in a short amount of time. I'd say all said and done, maybe this was like a 3-week effort to make it all happen. And today's the day. We should be getting electronic funds out the door this afternoon.
Wow, that's exciting. You're listening to Rainier Avenue Radio.world. It's me, Tony. Be my guest. Joining me is Mr. Darryl Smith, Executive Director of Homesight. If you've never heard of Homesight, as Biggie Smalls would say, if you don't know, now you know. How many applications did you get again for?
250.
250. How many folks were you able to help out with this
to
fund?
Date, we've been able to award 30 businesses $5,000 a piece. Wow. And we had a little press release that went out about that. And I won't go over the whole list. They're all deserving. But I will tell you that, you know, many of them are women-owned. A large number identify as African-American or African. They're all in the zip codes that we love and know, 98144, 98118, my own personal zip. So we're focusing on South Seattle because this is where Homesight's offices are, and these are all of our community, you know, members and family down here. So we wanted to really be, you know, sort of strategic and targeted. I'm very happy that the City of Seattle's Office of Economic Development came out a few days before us with their larger grants of $10,000 for many South Seattle businesses. So that was really great too, because, you know, help is needed everywhere, but we feel pretty special about where Homesight lives and does its primary practice through its offices, because we think we're, you know, the most diverse, you know, part of the city, and frankly, about the most part of the diverse part of the state down here. If you think about South Seattle and Willard, Renton, and all those areas where many of our borrowers and homeowners live, so it's special down here. We want to make sure that if we can play a small role in making sure it comes back the way, you know, frankly, that we want to see with that strength and that resiliency, we want to be a part of that that small story.
And Darryl, unfortunately, we're almost out of time here, but I'm glad that we got to have this conversation. You say that you're attempting to raise money to do another round. The donations have come from some major places. If folks say that they want to donate and be part of this, what can they do to help build some more money back up for this next round?
We want to make it as easy as possible. So all you have to do is go to Homesight's website, homesightwa.org, and check us out. There's plenty of things to explore on the website, but there's definitely a link there to contribute. And, you know, every dollar helps. So if you would like to be a part of that, anyone in your listening audience, Tony, that, you know, knows and loves South Seattle or is inspired by the community that's down here, because it is inspiring. It's a great place to live. I've been down here since 1994, wouldn't live anyplace else. It's easy to donate, and we want to cobble those funds together and get some support from some of our institutional supporters as well, and do a second round, because clearly the need certainly outweighed what we were able to do in this first round, and we recognize that, and there's a lot of deserving business owners that we want to support. So, and thank you again for having me on, Tony. I appreciate just the opportunity to share a little bit about this.
Okay, Darryl, I got about 30 seconds. If you want to have a final words, anything you want to share with our audience before we go into the next segment?
Absolutely. I can't stress enough that Homesight's mission of creating, you know, generational wealth in families is what we want to do and serve. And, you know, we don't have to, it's a whole nother show, of course, talking about displacement and gentrification, and we're trying to play a role in stopping that and helping to prevent it. So we love to have the opportunity to serve folks who would like to call in our market area. It doesn't have to necessarily just be South Seattle, obviously, too. But as we think about those areas where the cost of housing has really driven so many folks outside of the city of Seattle, we're here as a resource, and we can definitely help you through mortgage lending. We have up to $55,000 down payment assistance for those qualified purchasers, lots of different loan products. And if you're a neighborhood-based or community-based organization that would like to partner in some way to make where you are stronger, we'd love to hear from you as well and see if we can work together. So Homesight is here to stay as a community-based, place-based organization, and I'm real proud to serve it.
All right, Darryl, and you did a masterful job of taking that 30 seconds and stretching it out. Okay, my man. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you, Tony. And hopefully soon you and I will run into each other, as we always do, out in the Rainier Valley celebrations this summer. That's where I usually see you. So we'll be out there soon.
My man, Darryl, thanks again.
All right. Thank you, Tony. Take care. Bye-bye.
You're listening to RainierAvenueRadio.world. We'll be back with more from our coronavirus coverage in about 3 minutes, right after this.
You're listening to RainierAvenueRadio.world. Check us out on social media, Facebook and Instagram, RainierAvenueRadio.world, and on Twitter at RainierAvRadio.
1, 2, get down!
What's up, big and little homies? This is Masvita Maraire, host of Seattle Sports Weekly on RainierAvenueRadio.world, your one-stop shop for Seattle sports. We cover preps, we cover college, we cover pro, we cover it all. Huskies, Mariners, Seahawks, Garfield, South, Roosevelt, Metro, King County. This is where you want to listen to for all the sports that's happening in Seattle. Seattle Sports Weekly on RainierAvenueRadio.world.
Namati hinda barsina. Yo darga gesi virusi corona ting dibame, humahi tim fakatu. Fi diben ba e iti himulatu. Garu akao kedit yo kenite, isan akakayu kedit dabarsan. Oso himbekne, namni gutta gutu ni debama. Kanafu, itu yaduk abden, waye barasi corona ra. Akamiti, namati rabra, jechuni, jetani tiaduk abden. Namni ba e, waliti akka hin geni. Herka kesan ikatuk abden. Yo mana ta udan ditan, mana ta a. Nama irra, upegu kabden. Namati le hinda versina. Ergan kun, Mot Tajajila, Radio Rinari Avenue, or Fold Fee, Somali Youth and Family Club, Ra is Indida Barsina.
Check out Fresh Juice on Rainier Avenue Radio every Wednesday night, 9 to 11 p.m.
As we bring you the hottest new hip-hop, dope guests, and interviews with artists on the rise.
Plus, you know you can kick it with me, D-Money, and Evan B. Culture.
Every Wednesday night, 9 to 11 p.m. on RainierAvenueRadio.world. Fresh Juice.
This is Paul Pearson, host of Star Time. And when I'm not helping bad girls set up their websites, I'm listening to RainierAvenueRadio.world.
What is the coronavirus? Coronavirus is affecting people's ability questions, unanswered questions about the coronavirus.
What's the deal with
I feel like we're not getting the whole story about the coronavirus. There are several patients at the hospital who are at end of life. What is the coronavirus?
Coronavirus disease 2019, other known as COVID-19, is a respiratory illness that can spread from person to person. Patients with COVID-19 have had mild to severe respiratory illness with symptoms of fever, cough, and shortness of breath. There is currently no vaccine to protect against COVID-19. There is no specific antiviral treatment for COVID-19. If you're concerned and you have symptoms, don't go to urgent care. Call your provider or call the ER or urgent
care.
Or
if you don't have anyone's number, call King County's coronavirus line at 206-477-3977. Or if that line is busy, you can try 1-800-525-0127.
This message is a public service announcement of RainierAvenueRadio.org.
What is the coronavirus?
Got Funny, live on RainierAvenueRadio.world.
Every Tuesday, 7 p.m. to 7:30 p.m.
You got funny? Bring it.
Hey, y'all, it's me, Deontay, your host for Got Funny, where we got comedians, laughter, and a whole bunch of other... Join me Tuesdays at 7 p.m. to 7:30 right here on Rainier Avenue Radio World.
The coronavirus is real. Let's be diligent about washing our hands. Did you know that this virus can live on surfaces for up to 9 days? That's why it's also important to disinfect things that an infected person might touch, like your cell phone. Even if you wash your hands often, when you pull out your phone, those germs go right back on your hands. When's the last time that you cleaned your phone? When the virus is spread by sneezing or coughing, those tiny airborne droplets eventually land on surfaces that you touch with your hands. On average, we touch our face 16 times an hour, which is why it's important to wash your hands and wipe down commonly used surfaces, including your cell phone. This message is a public service of RainierAvenueRadio.world.
What's on your heart? Are you exhausted at the lack of progress for people of color in business, politics, and life? This is Cindy Bright, the host of Heartbeat Radio. Each week, we explore this heart condition of the country that is affecting you and me. We have real conversations about what's necessary for change. It's time to change this dialogue. Will you join this Heartbeat weekly, Wednesdays at 7 p.m. on Rainier Avenue Radio?